Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Too Young to Be Old: Love, Learn, Work, and Play as You Age, by Nancy K. Schlossberg, Doctor of Education, read by Kim Niemi. Introduction. Aging brings many challenges. Sometimes they can seem overwhelming. How do we feel as we confront these challenges? Do we experience love, envy, jealousy, or loneliness? Do we experience a fear of illness and death, or a fear of outliving our money and being unable to live on our current income? Or are we excited about the future? Are we excited about finding new interests, new companions, and new surroundings, even as some of the old, comfortable ones fall into the past? Too Young to Be Old tells a story about transitions and how to handle them, a story about aging and its possibilities, a story about living longer and living well. My mission in this book is to teach the principles of transition theory and positive aging through reporting on the research and sharing real-life experiences, mine and others, so that you can apply these principles to help navigate any major event, or non-event, in your life. Positive aging. Average life expectancy is continuing to trend upward. Nearly 80 million Americans are over the age of 55. Our country has more old people than ever, and they will, on average, be living longer than their forebears. For this ever-changing group, a key question is how to overcome the negative challenges of aging to get the most out of these extra final years. Like other phases of our lives, getting old presents us with transitions. Some transitions, such as the death of a spouse, may be forced on us. Others, such as moving from a house to an apartment or relocating to be closer to grandchildren, may be our choice. In this respect, aging is no different from any other phase of life. It is all too easy to focus on the negatives of aging: illness, physical and mental disability, loss of loved ones. But because our definitions of aging have changed statistically, and the average American now looks forward to more healthy years than his or her parents enjoyed, we are seeing an increasing shift in how people think about aging. From a deficit approach that focused on what we lost as we aged, we are shifting to a positive model that acknowledges that older people can make positive contributions to society, and that with aging, surprise, comes happiness. I, and others who have spent much of our lives studying adult development, call this new model positive aging. The aging process has emerged as a defining and challenging part of my personal life. I find it difficult to think of myself as old. But demographically, that is who I am. The combination of my personal and professional experience, in concert with interviewing many individuals, has led me to identify strategies that can boost your happiness and lead to positive aging, no matter what. This book describes these strategies in detail in each of the 11 chapters, focusing on these topics: talking back to your mirror, saying no to ageism, embracing change, diversifying your coping skills, creating your retirement fantasy, choosing your place, coping with health challenges, understanding your family transitions, keeping your dance card full, going for romance and/or intimacy if you want it, and creating your own path to positive aging. Aging and happiness. Over and over again, we encounter individuals with stories that support the thesis that we can be old and happy at the same time. All around us are examples suggesting that attitude and well-being are linked. Consider the case of an 80-year-old man who is legally blind. He told me he took 2 subways and a train to travel from Washington, D.C. to Baltimore to visit his granddaughter in the hospital. I commented on his ability to do what would seem impossible for most of us. He said, "I made up my mind not to be a tragic figure. I made up my mind to function as independently as I possibly could." Then there is the case of a 75-year-old woman who has endured many tragedies, including the death of one of her 4 children from a brain tumor, the death of her husband of 60 years, and the murder of her brother. She is starting a new chapter of her life. Her children helped her get online, where she met a new boyfriend. Now she is focusing on the future. One of the most memorable anecdotes about positive aging involves a 90-year-old widow who happily displayed the ring she received to signify her engagement to a 95-year-old man. She calls him her fiancé rather than her boyfriend or companion. They do not plan to marry, but they wanted a symbol of their commitment to each other. It may seem counterintuitive, but a growing body of research suggests that as people age, they become happier. Various studies tell us that even if we are confronted with difficult challenges, aging does not have to be only a time of worry, fear, and loss. One recent study, reported in Scientific American Mind, suggested that we can all look forward to aging happier. This study of several thousand Americans born between 1885 and 1980 revealed, after controlling for variables such as health, wealth, gender, ethnicity, and education, that well-being increases over everyone's lifetime. The exceptions might be people who lived through difficult historical periods, like the Great Depression, or veterans who served in war. Life experience may make a difference in long-term happiness, but people's attitude also may differ depending on which day you ask the question. I often ask people if they are happier as they get older, and as one woman answered, "It depends on when you ask me." Another researcher studied the paths of individuals from late adolescence to old age. George E. Valiant, who directed the Harvard study of adult development and wrote a book about it, concluded that successful positive aging depends on attitude and outlook. For example, Valiant observed that President Franklin D. Roosevelt suffered illnesses that would have merited a 100% disability from the Veterans Administration. Clearly, attitude and subjective health are as important to aging as objective physical health. He wrote that whether we live to a vigorous old age lies not so much in our stars or our genes as in ourselves. It may be tempting to dismiss this example because President Roosevelt was an exceptional person with significant resources. But there is plenty of other validation for this premise. Disabled persons who maintained positive beliefs are more likely to make a recovery, according to a study by Yale epidemiology and psychology professor Becca Levy. In fact, happiness is now a legitimate avenue for academic study. Martin Seligman, the founder of the positive psychology movement, suggested that we all have an emotional happiness baseline to which we inevitably return. According to Sonia Lubomirsky, author of The How of Happiness, one's happiness level is determined by 3 things. 50% of happiness comes from one's emotional baseline, 10% from one's life circumstances, and 40% from intentional activity. This book is about the 40% we can control as we age. Along with documenting the happiness experienced by older persons, researchers are increasingly examining what it takes to live longer. A 2014 article by the Harvard Medical School, Living to 100, What's the Secret?, concluded that if you bring to your life appreciation and respect and embrace aging with good humor, grace, vigor, and flexibility, you will, at the very least, be happy to grow old. The subtitle of a 2013 report by the Harvard Medical School says it all. Positive Psychology: Harnessing the Power of Happiness, Mindfulness, and Inner Strength. The report concluded that a sunny outlook might protect the heart and brain. For older persons as well as for younger ones, attitude can make all the difference between enhancing and enjoying your later years and focusing only on your problems. The people described earlier in this chapter, the newly engaged 90-year-old woman and the blind 80-year-old who crisscrosses Washington, D.C. and Maryland, are survivors who made up their minds to flourish. They do not know it, but they are part of the positive aging movement, which fosters resilience while focusing on one's strengths and happiness. Hundreds of books, articles, and conferences on the topic reflect the degree to which the movement has traction. So how can we do it? We cannot control our lives to avoid the downs. What we can control is the way we deal with the ups and downs of life. In other words, the resilience with which we manage change and the strategies we have in place to cope. And we can pay attention to the guidelines and strategies offered in this book, which will help promote positive aging. About me. I am an 87-year-old woman who endured several years as a widow in waiting. I have experienced retirement, the loss of my spouse, grief, recovery from grief and from my own physical problems, a return to dating in my 80s, finding a new love, and moving to a retirement community. I lived to tell the tale. As a retired professor of counseling psychology specializing in transitions, I am writing this book informed by my personal experience and by the knowledge and perspective afforded me by some 50 years of study and research, including hundreds of interviews on the transitions of aging. I bring two strains of experience to the task, professional and personal. First, I have been a student of adult development and aging since I was an assistant professor at Wayne State University and taught my first course in adult development at age 35. My subsequent career as a professor at the University of Maryland consisted of university teaching, conducting research, and writing 9 books about adult transitions. Over my long career, I have had the opportunity to interview hundreds of individuals and hear their stories about their personal lives and transitions. Even since my official retirement from academia at age 67, my professional life has continued to be personally rewarding, with extensive opportunities for speaking and writing. When I started teaching more than 50 years ago, aging was an abstract concept to me. Now, at 87, aging is no longer an abstraction. My own experience echoes that of the author Betty Friedan, who described her evolution while writing The Fountain of Age. When I started this book, Friedan said, it was about them. Now, it's about me. When I started studying and teaching about aging, it was about them. Now it is very much about me. So I bring my personal and professional lenses to the topic of how we can be positive agers. In addition, I have experienced a new kind of transition. Less observable, but as potent. For the first time, I felt the clock ticking and realized there are non-negotiable limits. Always before, if I did not reach a particular goal, I could say to myself, there is time to regroup and try it a different way. Now I feel differently. The transition of thinking of myself as having limited options has been gradual. But at the same time, it is an exciting period. I am curious about the future. How will I deal with this final period of my life? I am determined to think positively, although that is not always easy. It is different. I say my age without trying to hide it. After reading one of my published articles on aging, a woman I did not know called me up to say, "I wish you were my next-door neighbor so I could talk to you about my challenges and issues." The purpose of this book is to communicate what I have learned as a retired professor of counseling psychology, as an author of 9 books on transitions, and as someone who is actually living life as an old person. This book is for that woman who took the trouble to call me up, as well as for anyone else who is looking for guidance on how to successfully navigate the uncharted territory of getting old. The plan of this book. Too Young to Be Old is divided into 4 sections. Each of the 11 chapters recommends a broad strategy to help listeners through the many transitions that typically occur during life's later years. Part 1, Resolve Your Love-Hate Relationship with Aging, takes a frank look at the feelings that we experience as we age. It pinpoints our feeling that, even though we get the AARP membership offer, the wrinkles, the gray hair, and the Medicare card, we still feel young inside, and it suggests that some of our frustrations may emerge from our own ageism. Chapter 1, Talk Back to Your Mirror, suggests ways to overcome what is often the shock and dismay of how aging has changed us physically. Chapter 2, Just Say No to Ageism, confronts an issue that is often subtle and unrecognized, yet one that plays an important role in our sense of self and our possibilities as we age. Part 2, Understand Transitions, provides the context for understanding the structure of any transition. Chapter 3, Embrace Change, outlines the model of transitions I developed after 35 years of studying transitions. I describe the role of timing in transitions. Is the transition on time, off time, out of time, or no time / non-event? Chapter 4, Diversify Your Coping Skills, explains basic coping strategies that can help you master the many transitions connected with aging. Part 3, Navigate the Many Transitions of Aging, shows how the transition framework plays out in 4 transitions commonly experienced as we age. Each of the 4 chapters dissects one of these challenges: retiring, Chapter 5, Create Your Own Retirement Fantasy, deciding where to live, Chapter 6, Choose Your Place, Location, 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 coping with health issues, Chapter 7, Cope with Health Challenges, and coping with family issues, Chapter 8, Understand Your Family Transitions, and suggests how you can ace those transitions. Part 4, Create the New You, focuses on how you can approach the future positively. Chapter 9, Keep Your Dance Card Full, Pay Attention to Friends, Family, and Fun, underscores the importance of social engagement. And Chapter 10, Go for Romance, If You Want It, suggests that if you are still interested in romance, you should be open to it, regardless of your age. The final chapter, Create Your Own Happiness, Your Path to Positive Aging, describes ways that you can create your own happiness as you explore and improvise your road to positive aging. The research for this book. I specifically targeted several groups and individuals to learn more about the transitions discussed throughout the book. I participated in what I called conversation groups around the topic of health, money, and caregiving. I met with people at a senior center, a YMCA, a community center in a low-income area, and a healing circle at a library in a low-income area. In addition, I conducted 25 interviews with selected individuals. Summary: aging will continue to challenge us. Mastering these challenges is the goal of this book. Whether we are 60, 70, 80, 90, or even 100, we need all the signposts we can find to help us face the challenges ahead. This book is about the drama of our futures, which will be filled with unexpected twists and turns. We will be forced to improvise as we deal with the unknown. This is a book about how to learn, work, love, and play all through life. 1. Resolve your love-hate relationship with aging. 1. Talk back to your mirror. We face a conundrum. People desperately want to live longer, and yet at the same time, they go to great lengths not to look like they are living longer. Over and over, we hear ourselves saying, "I can't believe what I see in the mirror." In the article, Last Word, The French Do It Better, one woman was quoted as saying the following: "Nowadays, it is a shock to catch sight of myself in a mirror. I think, this can't be true. Someone has waved a hand and turned me into a woman of 80. When I meet my friends, I am invariably shocked. What wicked fairy has changed them into aging females?" To change their image, women and now men are flocking to plastic surgeons. According to the American Society of Plastic Surgeons, both women and men age 55 and older have undergone procedures like facelifts, eyelid operations, and breast lifts or reductions. Complementing, or perhaps staving off, the cosmetic surgery for aging Americans is the annual purchase of more than $2 billion in anti-aging skin products. Anti-aging cream sells well even during hard economic times. A marketing survey suggests that fighting back against our aging appearance will prompt an increase in the global expenditure for anti-aging products and services from the $249 billion spent on these products in 2012 to $346 billion in 2018. One woman in her early 70s informed one of my conversation groups that dyeing your hair is essential. You can look like someone's sister or aunt, but not the mother. What does this mean? This preoccupation reflects our love-hate relationship with aging, our fear of aging, and our resistance to its reality. Furthermore, the demographic reality is that nearly 1 in 5 Americans will be over the age of 65 by 2030. What do we fear? Aging is scary. One woman told me, "I feel very schizophrenic about aging. I would say I never felt better in my life. I did not know life could feel like this. Yet it does not look like a very positive future. It is a lot of endings. There is a real letting go of just about everything." Another woman said, "I think of old people having bad breath, stooped over with hair growing randomly out of their faces." When one 8-year-old child told her grandmother that she was getting old, her grandmother asked, "How do you know?" "The bumps on your hands," answered the granddaughter. We fear that our looks will give us away. We fear that we will become invisible and marginalized. Many women complain that no one whistles at them when they walk by anymore. We fear that we will outlive our money, that we will have a horrible end-of-life illness, that we will have less fun, less money, less sex, fewer opportunities. We fear that we will get Alzheimer's disease. According to Ted C. Fishman, author of Shock of Gray, we live with many realities of aging. In a speech, he presented two very different realities of aging presented by his family. His father was ill for 16 years, and Fishman rushed to his father's deathbed repeatedly. On the other hand, his 83-year-old mother, who was in the audience for his speech, was about to take a major trip. We fear that we will be like Fishman's father, not his mother. The underlying fear is the fear of dying, not the fear of death. I was flying home from Europe once when the pilot explained that we might be flying into a hurricane. I could feel my heart thumping and thought, how can I survive an 8-hour plane trip thinking about a hurricane? Then I asked myself, what is the worst that can happen? And the answer was, I will die. Then I tricked myself and said, let me think about the advantages of dying. First, I have not yet outlived my money, so my adult children would inherit a little money. Money that would be helpful to them and their families. Second, I would escape a long, horrible end-of-life illness. In other words, I faced down the worst scenario I could imagine at that moment. We spend a great deal of time thinking about aging. Do we look old? Do we have more wrinkles? Is our new birthday leading us into the scenario that we are old and are losing it? I have heard 50-year-olds, 70-year-olds, and 90-year-olds proclaim that they hate the new number. In one of my conversation groups, a woman who was approaching her 70th birthday shared her feelings of fear, particularly her fear of the end and of losing her identity. I do not feel old, but the label old is becoming part of my identity. How do you feel about telling your age? We can age with panache. Despite the fears and problems, keep in mind that according to the Pew Research Center on Social and Demographic Trends, getting old is not nearly as bad as people think. A survey on aging among a nationally representative sample of 2,969 adults, which looked at aspects of everyday life, ranging from mental acuity and physical dexterity to sexual activity and financial security, found a sizable gap between the expectations that young and middle-aged adults have about old age and the actual experiences reported by older adults themselves. These disparities come into sharpest focus when survey respondents are asked about negative benchmarks often associated with aging, such as illness, memory loss, an inability to drive, an end to sexual activity, a struggle with loneliness and depression, and difficulty paying bills. In every instance, older adults report experiencing these negative benchmarks at lower levels, often far lower, than younger adults report expecting to encounter them when they grow old. Many people think older adults are not happy. But the same factors that predict happiness among younger adults, good health, good friends, and financial security, by and large predict happiness among older adults. An AARP article by Beth Howard, What to Expect in Your 70s and Beyond, suggested that the 70s are the happiest years of your life. Howard quoted Laura Karstensen, director of the Stanford Center on Longevity, as attributing this impression to experience. As you get older, you know that bad times are going to pass. You also know that good times will pass, which makes those good times even more precious. In the same article, Bob Knight, a professor of gerontology and psychology at the USC Davis School of Gerontology, suggested that another factor that may contribute to a positive life in your 70s is having more control over your emotions, which makes it easier to rule out anger, stress, and negativity. Howard emphasized that we have the ability to prevent, or at least ameliorate, health issues by taking actions, such as remaining intellectually active to ward off loss of brain function and exercising to maintain muscle strength. Aging does not have to terminate your sex life, according to Howard, quoting studies showing that people in their 70s have active sex lives, despite often encountered erectile dysfunction among men and vaginal dryness among women. This type of research offers hope that we can, in fact, slow down or even stave off some of the physical effects of aging that we would prefer not to experience. In other words, we can age with panache, with flair, verve, and vigor. Ursula, who is about to celebrate her 100th birthday, said that aging with panache means dressing carefully each day, looking as good as one can. It means smiling and not making people feel sorry for you. It means being involved, staying interesting. It means living life to the fullest. There are many examples of people aging with panache. At the age of 62, Mikhail Baryshnikov danced at the 2010 Ringling Museum International Festival on an empty stage in front of a screen projecting a video of a young man dancing. The young man was Baryshnikov at an earlier age, and in the video, Baryshnikov was dancing with an even younger version of himself. There were three dancers: the younger, the older, and the shadow. At 62, he could no longer leap in the air, but he still created thrilling performances. He had style. But you do not have to be famous to age with panache. There are many ways to do it. A woman who lives in a nursing home wears colored flat shoes to match her sweaters. She explained, "Even though I can no longer wear high heels, I don't have to be dowdy." A retired investigative reporter no longer writes several stories a week. He paces himself and writes a bi-monthly column. An 87-year-old man who had been a mover and a shaker is currently trapped in a home with around-the-clock caregivers for his wife, who has Alzheimer's. He has enough money to do whatever pleases him, but no freedom. He feels guilty leaving his wife, but uncharacteristically, he took a 5-day vacation. There, he met a woman and began a romance. Where this romance will go is uncertain, but he made some important observations. He said people characterize old people, not realizing they have the same emotions and dreams they have always had. What he has missed was romance, fun, excitement, the joy of holding a woman. He and his friend went to a movie and held hands the entire time, just as he had done in his youth. Resolve the conundrum. It is too easy to be lulled into a feeling that life is better, that old people are happy, control their negative emotions, and enjoy love and romance. However, we cannot ignore the counter-argument that life is full of disappointment, loss, and sadness, that all around friends are dying, or worse, living with miserable health challenges. We do not need to hide our limitations, but we do need to seek new opportunities and new possibilities. That is what aging with panache is all about: figuring out your own lifetime of possibilities. Of course, that is easier said than done. It is fine to talk back to the mirror and say, "I want to look as good as I can." For some of us, applying anti-aging cream every night or wearing brightly colored clothing serves as a positive, tangible sign to ourselves and others that we can act as young as we feel. But we should not delude ourselves into thinking that physical touch-ups will get us through the emotional changes, disappointments, and frustrations that can result from the loss and illness of friends or family, and from the fear that our normal routines are gone forever. Remember the woman at the beginning of this chapter who said she could not believe that she and her friends had turned into aging females. She also said something about reconnecting with her friends. Something magical happens. I call it the second look. The mask of age falls away, and there are my friends as they existed for me always. Young, smiling, and the dear persons that I remember. She looked into the mirror, saw her friends as they were on that day, and then mentally reframed the image to imagine and relate to them as they always were. Your to-do list. It is the balance of love and hate that counts. If your hate about aging outweighs your love for your age, you need to figure out a way to turn the negatives into positives. Here are a few tips. Reframe the negatives. List the negatives and try to look at each one in a different way. Connect with people. If you see only losses and feel lonely, figure out some ways to connect with new groups. One woman realized her world was narrowing. She decided to go online as a way to meet new people. Count your blessings. What is good about your life? What gives you fun and comfort? One woman had many friends and activities, but dwelt on what she did not have. She had a choice: focus on what she did not have, or on what she did. Try something you did not think you could do. Try something that will make your friends, your neighbors, and your family say, "Now that's panache." For example, former President George H.W. Bush defied expectations by doing a tandem parachute jump on his 90th birthday. So do not be afraid to look in the mirror. You might be surprised by what you see. 2. Just say no to ageism. Koreans celebrate their 60th birthday as a joyous occasion that marks the passage into old age. In India, multi-generational families often live in the same household. Younger family members seek advice from the elders on issues such as finances and family conflicts. In Japan, each September, the country celebrates Revere the Elderly Day with special programs and gifts for the 80 and older crowd. Citizens who reach 100 receive a silver sake cup as a sign of respect. These are only some of the cultures in which aging brings respect and admiration. Unfortunately, these cultures stand in contrast to that of the United States, where all too often...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.